Good afternoon, and welcome to the University of Chicago Law School's seventh and final session of our weekly summer discussion on policing. I am Emily Buss, a faculty member at the law school, serving as the moderator for this series. One of the law school's important areas of academic research and clinical advocacy is policing and police reform. The goal of this series is to give our faculty the opportunity to share their work and to give our community the chance to discuss how these ideas relate to current efforts to reform policing. The sessions are designed to allow considerable time for your questions. This week's topic is civil lawsuits and qualified immunity. Today's speakers are Professors Will Baude and Craig Futterman. By now, some of you are very familiar with our ground rules. I will introduce each speaker, after which the speaker will have roughly 12 minutes to speak. At approximately 12:30, we will turn to your questions. Please send any questions you have as soon as you have them to me by chat. I will do my best to ask as many of your questions as I can with a focus on those most related to today's topics. I am pleased to begin today's discussion by introducing our first speaker, Will Baude. Will is a professor of law and Aaron Director of Research Scholar at the University of Chicago Law School, where he teaches federal courts, constitutional law, conflicts of law, and elements. He is co-editor of the textbook, The Constitution of the United States. He is also an affiliated scholar at the Center for the Study of Constitutional Originalism and a member of the American Law Institute. Will received his BS in mathematics from the University of Chicago and his JD from Yale Law School. He clerked for then Judge Michael McConnell on the United States Court of Appeals and Chief Justice John Roberts on the United States Supreme Court. Before joining the Chicago faculty, he was a fellow at the Stanford Constitutional Law Center and a lawyer at Robbins Russell LLP in Washington, D.C. Today, Will will discuss the doctrine of qualified immunity that has shielded police from liability and recent attempts to reform the doctrine in Congress and the Supreme Court. Welcome, Will.
Thank you, Emily. So the doctrine I'm here to talk about, as Emily said, is a doctrine called qualified immunity, which is one of the most important sort of formal legal barriers to suing government officials, especially police officers, for violating the Constitution. So I'm just gonna talk a little bit about where it came from, why it's a problem, and where it might go. So first, where it came from. 150 years ago, right after the Civil War, Congress enacted a statute called the Ku Klux Klan Act that was sort of one of the first foundational civil rights statutes. It said that any time a state government official violates your constitutional rights, you have the right to sue them and to get damages, to get other remedies, but especially to get damages for recompense for any kind of constitutional wrong you've suffered. That was supposed to be one of the main engines for enforcing constitutional rights against the states. 100 years later, in 1967, the Supreme Court decided that this statute shouldn't be read at face value, that it shouldn't allow you to just sue a police officer anytime they committed a constitutional violation, that surely Congress would have meant that if the police officer acts in good faith, if they didn't necessarily know what they were doing was unconstitutional, then they're not liable. They get a sort of a free pass if they acted in good faith. That's in a case called Pearson versus Ray. It's sort of the first case that sends things down this path. And over the course of the next 50 years, the Supreme Court sort of reinterprets this good faith doctrine in various ways and eventually labels it what's now called the doctrine of qualified immunity. What that's come to be is an objective test that says you cannot hold a government official for violating a government official liable for violating the Constitution unless they violate what's called clearly established law. That doesn't sound so bad, lots of laws clearly established, surely that makes sense. But the Supreme Court has said, What it means to violate clearly established law is not just that a government official violates the Constitution. That doesn't count as clearly established law. Not even that they violate sort of a fundamental Supreme Court case saying, you have a right not to have deadly force used against you if it's unreasonable. You have a right not to have excessive force used against you. But they have to violate something that's so clear, that's sort of been so clearly established by judicial precedent that the court says, Only the plainly incompetent or those who knowingly violate the law can be held liable. So you have to be plainly incompetent, the police officer has to be plainly incompetent or knowingly violate the law to be liable. And in practice, this means that the even if the facts of your case seem quite egregious, if lots of people think it was unconstitutional, if you can't point to another case that's very similar to this happening, then the courts will say, well, that doesn't count. That's not clearly established. You're not liable. So just to take one very recent example of a case that was in the lower courts and then the Supreme Court declined to hear, a case called West versus Winfield. There was a woman. There was a woman who was walking back to her house, and the police sort of find her on the street outside of her house and explain that they're looking for her ex-boyfriend, who's apparently a fugitive from justice, and they think he might be in her house. She says, he's not, but he's not. And they say, well, do you mind if we go inside your house to look? She says, that's fine, and hands them the key. They go to the house, they try the key, they can't get it to work, I think because the door has another lock, so it doesn't quite work. So they're a little flummoxed, and they do, the obvious next step, not so obvious. They go back to the city, their lawyer. The lawyer advises them that it's okay to do the following. Get a bunch of grenade launchers, and then fire tear gas grenades through all the windows of the house to coat the whole thing in poisonous tear gas to see if anybody's inside. So they do that. There's nobody inside, by the way. And they render the house uninhabitable for months. Now, they had no warrant. They had not even a very good reason to believe anybody's inside the house. They didn't have the homeowner's consent to blow holes in her windows and, fill her house with tear gas. But the Ninth Circuit said it wasn't clear that they acted unconstitutionally when they did this. While they didn't really have her consent, maybe a reasonable officer could have been mistaken and thought that when she handed them the key, that also meant that if the key didn't work, they could take next steps like bombarding her house with grenades. So the lawyers went to the Supreme Court and said, shouldn't somebody in this situation be allowed to recover? And the Supreme Court denied review and, was uninterested. So the qualified immunity just keeps this from getting any kind of recovery. And there are lots of cases like this. This is a kind of a frequent fact pattern to be able to pierce qualified immunity and get a, federal verdict for violating constitutional rights is at this point the exception and not the rule. Now, maybe this is just obvious to people why this is a problem, but I'll just add sort of two reasons that this doctrine has come under sort of heavy critique. One is legal. So it's not really clear where the Supreme Court got the authority to add this to the statute. This wasn't in the text of the statute that Congress enacted. The court has occasionally hinted that maybe this was a kind of well-established historical principle back in the 19th century that just kind of Congress surely meant to include, but best reading of the history is that there wasn't any principle like this that gave this kind of blanket immunity. So it seems to be a sort of a judicial invention added on top of the statute without sort of Congress's permission, which is not something the courts are normally supposed to do to statutes. And then on the practical side, what this doctrine does is it makes it very hard for victims of police misconduct to recover anything, at least in federal court, as a matter of constitutional law. And maybe for no good reason. So police officers themselves are almost always indemnified against tort judgments by their employer, by insurance companies. So the doctrine isn't even necessary exactly to protect police officers from personal liability. So it sort of stamps out remedies without necessarily having any real good purpose and without having any real good legal pedigree either. It seems to be making things harder and for no good reason. I go a lot more into detail about it when people want to ask questions, but that's the overview of the reasons people have been skeptical about it. Now, in the past few years, for a long time, this has just been a fixture of constitutional doctrine. But in the past few years, it's come under much more criticism. Several justices of the Supreme Court have said that something has gone wrong with qualified immunity doctrine, and they'd be interested in fixing it. On the one hand, Justice Clarence Thomas, one of the most conservative justices on the court, has written several opinions saying, this doctrine doesn't seem to have any kind of historical or textual basis, and I'm not convinced that we should have it. We ought to get rid of it. On the other hand, Justice Sotomayor, joined by Justice Ginsburg, some of the most liberal members of the court, have said, this doctrine seems to be incredibly one-sided and to largely operate to make constitutional lawsuits almost impossible for plaintiffs to win, and we need to do something to bring it down to something more reasonable. So people have started filing lots of cert petitions to the court asking them to reconsider the doctrine of qualified immunity, either to get rid of it or to reframe it or to talk about various ways in which it could be made a little more modest. We can talk about that as well. And over the past year, the Supreme Court seemed to be considering it. This is kind of technical Supreme Court practice stuff, but for months, the Supreme Court was taking lots of cases where people were asking them to reconsider this question. The court doesn't agree to hear these cases until they sort of decide they want to, but they had them sitting in the conference room over and over again. Should we agree to reconsider this doctrine? So people thought they might be ready to reconsider the doctrine. I filed some amicus briefs in several of those cases. Emily's put a link to one of them in the chat. Professor Boss has put a link to one of them in the chat, saying, you know, the time has come to reconsider this doctrine. We have many different views of what you could do instead, but there's a broad consensus that something needs to be done. And then over the summer, the Supreme Court denied review in all these cases. When the Supreme Court denies review, they don't say why. They don't say, you know, they don't say anything. They just say review is denied. Justice Thomas wrote separately to say we really ought to hear these cases, but we don't know even if other justices besides Justice Thomas were interested, if they had reasons for disagreeing, if they're waiting for a different case. All we know is, you know, for now, the Supreme Court is not hearing them. So on the one hand, at least three justices have said the court ought to do something. On the other hand, the court has so far not done anything. Now, that could be because most of the justices think things are just fine. You know, the court came up with this doctrine. They might be happy with it. They might not think there's a problem. They might disagree with the rest of us. Or it could be that the court doesn't want to step in because they're hoping somebody else will solve the problem. So because this doctrine is a matter of statutory interpretation, even though it's something that came from court decisions, but because it's a matter of statutory interpretation, Congress also has the power to change or get rid of the doctrine of qualified immunity anytime they want to. In fact, they would basically only have to add one sentence to the civil rights statute to get rid of the doctrine. And at the same time that these cases have been pending before the court, there have been several bills introduced in Congress that would either completely eliminate or dramatically reduce the doctrine of qualified immunity. One is part of one of the Democratic House bigger police reform bills. The other one was introduced by a libertarian member of Congress, Justin Amash, and has bipartisan sponsors on both sides. Neither of those has passed the House. Certainly, neither of those has passed the Senate. It's hard to imagine the president signing them into law, but they're on the agenda. And they may be on the agenda again the next time police reform is before Congress. So it's possible that the Supreme Court thought, well, we don't need to get involved in this right now because, you know, members of Congress are actually thinking about this and we ought to let them decide what to do about this. We ought to let that play out. That's a plausible thing the court might have thought. Now, at the moment, those bills are not going anywhere in Congress either. As I said, there are bills that have passed, they've got some support, but there are three major steps that have to happen before a bill can become a law. It has to pass the House, it has to pass the Senate, it has to be signed with the president. These bills have not had any of those steps happen yet. And even if one happens, the other two may not happen, but they're there as a possibility. Now, one thing I worry about is that, you know, the court is thinking, we don't need to do anything about this problem because we're waiting for Congress to fix it. Congress is better situated to fix it. And members of Congress might also think, well, we don't really need to do anything with this problem either because, you know, it's really the court's problem. They came up with this doctrine, they can always get rid of it, so we'll just let the court fix it. And both Congress and the court might just be sort of standing around, pointing to the other one, waiting for somebody else to take responsibility for this doctrine when maybe nobody will.
Thank you, Will. Our next speaker is Professor Craig Futterman. Craig is a clinical professor of law at the University of Chicago Law School, and he founded the Civil Rights and Police Accountability Project of the Mandel Legal Aid Clinic in 2000, where he serves as its director. Before his appointment to the law faculty, Professor Futterman was a lecturer in law and director of public interest programs at Stanford Law School. He previously practiced law at the boutique firm of Futterman and Howard, where he specialized in civil rights and constitutional matters with a special focus on race discrimination, education, and police brutality. Before that, he served as a trial attorney in the Juvenile Division of the Cook County Public Defender's Office. Oh, excuse me. Professor Futterman received his JD from Stanford Law School and his BA in Sociology and Economics from Northwestern University. Today, he will reflect on his 20 years of experience pursuing civil rights litigation focused on police misconduct in the clinic, and how this experience informs his thinking of current events and efforts at reform. Welcome, Welcome, Craig.
Thanks, Emily, and thanks, Will. Like so many others, I've been profoundly shaken by the recent killings of Ahmaud Arbery, George Floyd, Breonna Taylor. And I hope, and Emily already gave you a preview of this, I hope I don't disappoint, but I'm gonna try to do something that's a little bit different than what was originally billed. And while I'll share a touch of background and some couple ideas about the law, I'm gonna resist, though, offering a doctrinal presentation on Section 1983 civil rights suits. It feels a little bit too sterile for the present moment. And I'm gonna do as Emily said, and I hope to offer something that will feel a little bit more conversational and some personal reflections on these past 20 years in the clinic and engaging in civil rights litigation. But since I was asked to talk about address civil rights litigation, let me just start by saying what may be the obvious, at least for someone like me. Civil rights lawsuits are good. I agree with Will. We should eliminate the doctrine of qualified immunity, as Will explained, has immunized officers and other public officials from civil liability, even when they violated folks' constitutional rights. As Will said, far too many people have been abused by the police. Far too many people who have been abused by the police are able to bring much less win cases in court. If you're Black, brown, poor, you're arrested, abused by the police, really hard even to get a lawyer unless you suffer a catastrophic injury or there's video. And even harder if you have a criminal record, and it's even harder to win. Vast majority of people who bring these cases against the police never even get to trial as a result of many of the procedural barriers, including that of the doctrine of qualified immunity that Will talked about. Courtroom doors often closed to victims of police abuse by the doctrine of qualified immunity, and that insulates individual officers on the one hand, and then some very stringent requirements that I won't talk about right now with respect to holding municipalities and cities liable. Similarly, in the rare case that actually gets to trial, civil rights plaintiffs lose far more than they win. And while video is beginning to change this a bit, most police abuse still continues to take place in the shadows outside of public view, where it often still comes down to the word of the police against the word of the person arrested, and the person arrested often criminalized, typically also racially stamped. We still don't want to believe and can't believe the people who we trust to keep us safe turn predatory. And I think we should think about, for those of you who were here last week and heard Professor Conyer's question, who is the we in that last statement I just said, and who's the us? Because the we excludes entire communities who live with the intimate knowledge of abusive policing. And that's translated also into unrepresentative juries and juries that have systematically excluded Black folks in civil rights cases, notwithstanding Batson. Juries that don't look anything like the folks who are most abused by police, and juries who tend to believe the testimony of police because they're police. People who have had negative experiences with police, people who live with the reality of systemic police abuse as a part of our daily existence, are excluded from jury service in civil rights cases, typically for cause. Even with all these barriers, so just to move forward, even with all those barriers to justice, in the last 10 years or so, the city of Chicago has paid out more than a half billion dollars as a result of police misconduct. And yet here we are. So as we discuss civil rights litigation and the qualified immunity doctrine, we also got to ask the fundamental question, which is, has even this massive liability put an end to pattern and practices of civil rights abuses in our city? Has resulted in police accountability in cities like Chicago? A few other just preliminary comments before I kind of get real. In conversations like these about police reform, we also opt to often overlook the importance of reparations and compensation to victims of police abuse. While we rightly talk about deterrence, we talk about change, we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that there are real people who've been seriously hurt who we have a duty to compensate. And so as a matter of doctrine, I do think it's good and right that police departments are forced to bear the cost of people who their officers injured. Again, civil rights lawsuits are good. Another reality that Will mention, and I'll just mention in passing, and that may frustrate those of us who believe in accountability, is that individual police officers rarely pay any part of the settlements or judgments when they abuse people. There was a recent study done by Joanna Schwartz at UCLA that found that local governments and not individual police officers have paid 99.98% of the money recovered by civil rights victims in police abuse cases. To be clear, I'm not arguing against indemnity, and which is typically a matter of both state and local law and often collective bargaining agreements between police and municipalities. And particularly, I'm not arguing against that because in jurisdictions without indemnification, victims tend to lack any means of redress. But there's some things that we should think about there. The final introductory point before getting real, or introductory point about the law, and I think critically important to any conversation about the role of civil rights litigation in producing reform, is that it is rare that the law allows victims to sue police departments for equitable relief, to sue for an injunction, to enforce change. Even when people are able to prove that their abuse is the direct result of an unconstitutional policy or practice of a municipality, a city, of a department, they generally don't have the power to win in order to tell police to cut it out. And so in my view, if we're talking about an area of civil rights litigation and an area for Congress to step in and take up for when considering legal reforms to civil rights litigation, to specifically allow people whose rights have been violated as a result of a policy or practice of a police department, I think this is an area where some true reform is needed, to allow for suits for injunctive relief to address a now few decade old Supreme Court decision, a case called Lyons versus the City of Los Angeles. And in my opinion, that legal reform would make a far bigger difference, and I support the elimination of qualified immunity, but would make a far bigger difference than the elimination of qualified immunity if we're interested in ending patterns and practices of civil rights violations. One final just legal note is, unlike ordinary people who've been hurt by police, the U.S. Attorney General does have the power to bring what are called civil rights pattern and practice lawsuits against local law enforcement seeking injunctions or consent decrees. There's been a law in effect since about 1994, and those civil rights suits, those pattern and practice suits brought by the federal government, by the Attorney General, have indeed resulted in some meaningful reforms in many local departments around the United States. Another just present reality is that the Trump administration stopped bringing these cases, just plain and simple, and has retreated from enforcing the consent decrees already in place that preceded his office. All right, so now for the real talk in my remaining minutes. It should come as no surprise to anyone in this, even in this virtual room, that I believe in police accountability. I mean, shoot, I direct a police accountability project at the law school for the last 20 years. But it's really more than fair to ask, and particularly here in Chicago, a city that I work and love, is there a regime of police accountability here? What good have we been doing? Has the litigation component of our civil rights clinic over the last 20 years, has it been a failure? Outside my grandparents, my own hero growing up was Malcolm X, radical man. And just before I was born, as you know, Malcolm famously declared, we declare this right, our right on this earth to be a man, to be a human being, to be respected as a human being, to be given the rights of a human being in the society, on this earth, in this day, which we intend to bring into existence by what any means necessary. That's why I see civil rights litigation, one of the many means necessary in a fight against racism, institutional denial, and police violence. A tool, though, that can both create and limit possibilities for change at the same time, especially if we're not careful. It's been a tool to reinforce power hierarchies and maintain the status quo, to justify the subordination of Black folks. Y'all have heard Audre Lorde's admonition, master tools will never take down the master's house. And I agree that we gotta be careful with those tools and recognize both what they are and their limits. But I'm also incredibly aware of critiques, particularly from the white left, but also from some Black folk, based on the theory that the legal system is illegitimate, and so we must reject tools that have been valuable to Black and other oppressed folk in fights for freedom. We shouldn't be too quick, at least in my opinion, turn our backs on tools that can reduce harm, reduce pain, save lives, while we continue to fight for a better world. I've seen with my own eyes how we can use civil rights litigation to build power in communities, to fight injustice, reduce human suffering, and I'm proud of the many ways in which we've used that tool in our clinic right here in the law school. So my few brags, we've helped real families in need, real people, Black women sexually abused by police, immigrant families targeted for robbery, false arrest, public housing resident tortured with a chainsaw by a sadistic group of officers, a young homeless man forced to falsely confess to a brutal murder of his own mom. We've seen how just helping one person, one family, can be transformative in and of itself. We've also seen and we've supported people fighting for change on the ground, challenging things like secrecy, denial, impunity, exposing conditions of impunity and denial, redistributing power from police to community. Some examples, one, class action early on in the clinic, challenging a police public raid of a public housing basketball tournament. We ended a practice of incommunicado detention of witnesses and interrogation rooms. We won the appointment of a special prosecutor to investigate criminal charges against the infamous police commander John Burge for torturing more than 100 Black men in Chicago. We challenged and successfully challenged all the way to U.S. Supreme Court civil forfeiture procedures in Cook County, defeated a police union's attempt to destroy police misconduct records, established the legal principle that police misconduct records in Illinois belong to the people, and created a database to actually make that real, exposed patterns of criminal behavior by entire units of the police department, brought international attention, obviously, through the Laquan McDonald case by exposing the video in our fight for the truth, and also exposing the routine operation of the code of silence and covering up of murders and police abuse, and brought an independent petition to actually see the very first successful murder prosecution of an on-duty Chicago police officer for killing a Black man, woman, or child in Chicago. So we've worked to transform and seen how litigation, and even through some of the most recent work in a community-based lawsuit, the exception that actually brought a consent decree to Chicago to oversee, a federal judge to oversee the Chicago Police Department that's enforceable by our clients, people who've been most impacted by police abuse. So what's typically offered in panels like these are calls for things like more body cams, better training, community policing, and I'm not here to dog that stuff. But the emphasis on those as primary remedies masks the reality of the problem, and it serves to deny, in my opinion, the reality of experience of all too many Black and brown folks in Chicago. Because the answer is not if police and Black folks had more positive interactions and knew one another better, that everything would all be kumbaya. And it's not that, of course, communication, empathy, good things. But the reason why folks are in the street isn't because of our failure to understand one another. It's because of police abuse, racism, dishonesty, lying, secrecy, impunity, our state of mass incarceration. So any real solution must speak to those problems. Be honest with people, stop lying, dismantle machinery denial, recognize that information is power, and redistribute that power to people. Hold police officers accountable when they abuse those powers or lie. And most importantly, just quit it. Stop arresting, beating, and killing so many Black people. Eliminate so many of these unnecessary negative encounters. Got to address racism in policing as an institution. Any real solution must begin with questioning the very role police have played in America, and in particular in exercising control over Black bodies, from slave patrols, Black codes, Jim Crow, to the present state of mass incarceration. I'll finish here, so much more to say, but as much progress we've made in the last two decades in the clinic, racism obviously persists. Nearly 90% of documented instances of police violence in Chicago still perpetrated against Black and brown people. And while I'm happy to brag about the amazing work of our students in the clinic, the fundamental questions still raised by young people in the streets remain. And after all this, and I think, and this can be a conversation that we have, but I think it would be irresponsible if we didn't ask, is the institution of policing itself the problem? And that's something that I've been struggling with for a while. And while I don't pretend to have all the answers, I am excited by this moment, because the powerful activism on the ground, our growth of consciousness as a nation, and even this forced stop by COVID, of the so many ways in which we've done things as a result, have created opportunities to experiment, the opportunities to be creative, to try different things, different towns, cities around the country, to learn and to grow. It's difficult to change things unless we can imagine them being different, unless we can imagine things not having to be the way they are, that we can do something better. I'm glad to share more of my vision of what that could look like, but I feel like I've gone on too much, but that's a bit of just what we've seen and experienced, at least some of the reflection that I have, and some of the fundamental questions that I think still we got to grapple with. Is this institution capable of reform? Are there problems fundamentally with the institution itself?
So not too much, but just enough. So we wanted to leave the rest of the time for questions. And maybe I'll start there, Craig, because you frame the question of the pluses and the minus, the positives and negatives of using litigation to accomplish the kinds of ends. I wanted to talk a little bit more about the consent decree direction, because you sort of, body cams, et cetera, they're only a small part of the, they're a part of the solution, but not fundamental change agents. Can consent decrees get at those big questions you ended with? In your own experience with the consent decree here, your knowledge of consent decrees in general, and your general sense as a lawyer who does this work, is there hope that a consent decree process could actually be a process to get at these very big questions that you ended with?
Yes, but not as the end all and be all. I think it can be an important component and a powerful tool as part of a process of ending and eradicating patterns of civil rights violations within local law enforcement. But it can't be the only thing. And in terms of just concrete, we've seen real progress. We've seen real change in police departments that have been under decrees. And we've seen a few things. One, that change doesn't occur overnight. The problems didn't begin overnight, and they're not going to end overnight. We've seen that change best occurs when there is buy-in, and ultimately buy-in by those who are in power. But probably the most important thing that we've seen in terms of successes and failures, and back to just consent decrees we've seen, so just to be also very concrete, in many jurisdictions with consent decrees, we've seen the amount of complaints against police go down. We've seen use of force go down, use of force incidents go down, incidents of police violence go down. We've seen violence against police go up. One of the things consent decrees are really good at are policy, and policy does matter. But culture trumps policy all the time and every day. And so maybe just the final point I'll make here, because I can go on for a long time, but the final point I'll make here about where and how consent decrees are most successful. And I think this is something that we have an opportunity uniquely here in Chicago to really make, to really lift up. They've been most successful in places where communities haven't been left on the sidelines, where the people who've been most impacted and most impacted by police abuse have had a seat at the table and have had not just a seat, but real power, and have been a real partner in the change effort. When it's been simply U.S. Department of Justice guiding this individual police officers, both line officers on the sidelines and community, and most importantly, people who've been most impacted on the sidelines, that's where we've seen the least success. And one of the things that I think that the DOJ was most learning toward the very end of the Obama administration and was just beginning to experiment in Seattle was a place where Seattle and Cincinnati were places where we've seen more community engagement interaction, where the DOJ itself was beginning to recognize that community groups have been most impacted need to be part and parcel and incorporated into the consent decree itself. And that's one of the unique things, and actually it is a unique thing about the Chicago decree, to my knowledge, the first government consent decree and a police decree in which community-based organizations actually have the power to enforce that decree in court.
So maybe just one follow-up on that. It makes all the sense in the world that the concerned community should have a place at the table. What have you seen in terms of the difference that brings about, in terms of either different demands, different way that the conversation proceeds? How does that play out?
Well, all too often, the people in communities who've been most impacted by police abuse and have also a wealth of lived experience about the nature and the fundamental reality and what needs to be done. I'm not saying have the exclusive knowledge, but have real knowledge, wisdom, experience, And that knowledge, wisdom, experience has been systematically excluded from the kinds of conversations that we're having right now, including academic conversations about also policy and practice. In terms of then how this can change or how this is changing, what I've observed, I wish I could say, oh, here, it's working so well right now in Chicago, because the reality and truth is it isn't at this moment. What we've seen thus far has been the city being utterly resistant to really welcoming into the conversation in more than a faux way. So it's like, oh, we have a part of consent decree, you must have community engagement on X, Y, and Z. So it's one thing to say, okay, we'll bring you in the room, check that box. And thus far in Chicago, what I've seen in terms of commitment or lack of commitment to reform has been much more of a check the box approach than a genuine approach for those conversations to occur. But that said, I was just in a meeting last night about use of force policy in Chicago. And as a result of the consent decree, there's a community based set of groups, including then with national experts as well, but based here in Chicago, that are looking at and providing feedback about what should Chicago's use of force policy look like. The ideas that are coming out of this group, I can say, are transformative, powerful, and ideas that I haven't seen implemented around the nation, and I think ideas that can make a difference. The open question is, now as these ideas come out of these groups, will they be taken seriously and actually implemented? And it's too early to say.
Okay, so I don't want to ignore Will for too long, but I want one more follow-up. What's an example of a transformative idea that you're hearing, or is it not information you can share? I think people are really eager for the, hungry for the concrete about it's very believable that the communities affected have tremendous wisdom, and it's really important to include them. What are the kinds of wisdom that you're seeing?
So maybe this is some of this stuff may not sound so. When we're talking about just policy, and use of force policy, some of this may not sound as utterly transformative, but a lot of it goes toward a shift of mindset. And so this won't sound all out and out radical, but first, just folks who have experienced, who've been over-policed and subject to an overabundance of police violence. And so maybe this isn't such a radical idea, but what I've heard consistently is just the idea that not just deadly force, but force being really, truly a measure of last resort, really and truly being used only, not just when reasonable under the law, but only when necessary. And only after exhausting all other available means. And then a heavy emphasis also on just a vision of how to avoid the need to use force in the first place. A lot of our law looks at all too frequently, just focuses on that last second, that last moment, the split second, which is really a myth in reality. It's rare that officers are making just the split second decision about whether or not to use force. The reality is there are a series of decisions and actions that really determine that split second and have the possibility of avoiding that split second. So a lot of what I'm hearing in the group has to do with how to avoid and what we can learn about avoiding that split second so that we're not just putting officers in situations where split second decisions are being made and bad decisions are often made.
Thanks. Will, so one of the things I really like about this session is that Craig is very much focused sort of on the ground, sort of playing this out and hearing those conversations. Of course, Will more focusing broadly doctrinally. Of course, both of those have huge implications for how the law plays out on the ground. But getting back to your discussion of, so it might be the courts, it might be Congress, the courts and Congress may both be sort of eager for the other to take the big step. I wondered if you could comment comparatively in a few ways. One, just your bet of what is more likely, which of these institutions is more likely to actually change the qualified immunity. Two, change means wiping it out, making it more qualified, in some way tweaking. Is there any of that on the table? And sort of as a piece of that, not so much just where more likely, but what would, in your view, be the best source of the change and the best sort of change?
Yeah. So it's hard. I'm not holding my breath for anybody to change things.
And can I, before you go further, is that because, in fact, even though some justices and some people in Congress want change, at least as many more don't?
Yeah. I mean, well, I think a lot of people don't think about it either way. And I think a lot of people in power, people in Congress and people in the Supreme Court, when they're thinking about, you know, the police officer reacting a split second to a situation on the street, they put themselves more in the shoes of the police officer than in the shoes of the victim of the police officer. So I can't say who this was, but I once gave a draft of this paper about qualified immunity at a workshop where a federal judge was there. And the federal judge's comment on the paper was, wow, it sort of seems from this paper like you think we should get rid of the doctrine of qualified immunity, but that can't be what you mean, because it's hard to imagine any rational lawmaker ever thinking, you know, we should just let people be sued for their constitutional violations. And then he told a story about how he served in government. His story was, I mean, I served in government, and just imagine if people could sue me for the things I did. That was his, you know, obviously not. And he was a quite liberal judge appointed by President Obama to a, you know, prominent court. Again, I can't say what it is, but I think that's a, you know, that's a widespread instinct. And some people, a few people don't have that instinct. A few people can get over that instinct, but that's still like a common, if you're a member of Congress or if you're a judge, you know, you're in the government. And so when people start talking about suing people in the government, that makes you nervous. And that's, you're much more likely to have been sued than you are to have been the victim of police violence if you're a judge or a member of Congress. I think that's just a hard thing to get over. Now, that said, I think the other two questions you asked are related, sort of what does reform look like and who would do it? So I think it's easier to imagine any kind of dramatic reform coming from Congress. I think a big step, like let's just dramatically eliminate the doctrine. I think it's easier to imagine Congress being the one to take that kind of step, that the courts, when they proceed in legal change, are much more likely to proceed kind of step by step or bit by bit. And Congress would be the more likely one to just say, let's wipe the slate clean. I don't think that's super likely, although it's not crazy. Again, when an ordinary person, when a civilian violates the law, there's an old maxim of criminal law that ignorance of the law is no excuse. So, you know, you don't get to get out of very serious legal trouble just because you didn't realize that that's what the law was, that the law was kind of unclear. You know, we're expected to figure out what the law is and to be conservative and to govern ourselves accordingly. So it wouldn't be crazy to think that police officers who wield the power of the state to enforce the law against us ought to know the law at least as well as the rest of us and be sort of held accountable. But I'm not holding my breath. I think it's easier to imagine the Supreme Court doing something very modest that would still be very important, like taking a case where there was an outrageous abuse of power and saying, no, qualified immunity doesn't apply to this situation. The Supreme Court literally has not found a police officer liable or held something to violate clearly established law in more than 15 years. And in my lifetime, it's only done so twice in sort of two isolated cases about 15 years ago. So even not even formally reforming the doctrine, but just taking a couple of cases and saying, yes, we see these are happening. To be clear, this is the kind of thing where there should be recovery, I think would you know, create a sort of subtle change in the doctrine and would send a message to courts that, okay, this is not supposed to be impossible. You know, how much of a difference does that make in practice? It's a nudge, right? It's not going to reform the system in any of the ways we need and that those fundamentals I'm talking about. But at the moment, I think there's kind of a culture. There are lots of judges who sit on lower courts who in the entire time they've been judges, the Supreme Court has never said, oh, this is when somebody's supposed to be liable. You know, they've been on the courts for less than 15 years. They've just, as a judge, they've never seen a case where the Supreme Court has said, okay, there's supposed to be a remedy here. And that creates a culture of saying, you know, no.
Thank you. So Craig, back to you, something you mentioned fairly early in your talk that I wanted to follow up on, which is the composition of juries. And if I'm remembering correctly, the Van Dyke jury in the Laquan McDonald shooting had maybe one juror who was a person of color or an African-American person. Can you say a little bit more? This has come up in other weeks. How does that come about in a case tried in, it's a county case, right? How what is the process that produces that result?
Well, there are lots of things, but I'll just focus on one thing that ought to feel painfully obvious. So in voir dire, in jury voir dire, if you're seen as someone who can't be fair, and can't be fair to both sides based on experiences that you've had, whether you are, that you can't be fair to both sides, or to any particular side, you can be challenged for cause. And then also there are the opportunity for peremptory challenges when folks also are deemed to be perhaps identified as being biased against your side. But I'm sorry, to get to the point that I was going to make is that my clients, community folks who I work with, live with the reality of police abuse as like breathing the air. It's like the weather. My students and I have worked for probably the last 7 or 8 years talking with Black high school students on the South Side of Chicago just about their experiences with the police. And among the things that just jump out starkly are that virtually every student that we've talked with knows someone well or themselves have had a traumatic experience related to an arrest or abuse by a Chicago police officer. My kids who went to lab school, and I remember having a similar conversation with probably 150 or so lab students, and not a one of them had ever been stopped by the police before. And this is at a school that was actually about 3 or 4 blocks away from another school, Hyde Park High, where I was having similar conversations with kids. And so when then selecting juries, if you've had experience or you know people or people you care about have had experiences or felt mistreated or abused by the police, most judges will allow those folks to be kicked off as a matter of cause. And so that means what that results in is systematic exclusion of people who are, the entire populations who have experience and knowledge, firsthand lived experience and knowledge or vicarious experience and knowledge through family members and people who are close to them with the reality of police abuse. And that right there biases who's on the juries. And so if you're talking about then Black communities and particularly lower income Black communities or the most over-policed Black communities, you're talking about the systematic exclusion of those folks from the jury. And that's, if we want to start thinking about that, what are the jury?
I think did we just lose Craig? Oh. I think we just lost. Craig, we lost you. Can you repeat? At least, I think you were out for a little bit. Unstable internet, as they say, but not metaphorically. But do you want to just repeat your last sentence?
I think I basically said it before. Bottom line is you see, the very folks who have knowledge of systematic police abuse will be generally systematically excluded, often for cause.
Okay. And what are the, do you know what the original pools look like in terms of the numbers?
I don't have the numbers, but if you're looking at federal and you're asking about Chicago in particular, and I think this was talked about last week or the week before in these conversations. The veneer itself includes the collar counties, the suburbs, and so just even in the beginning.
Oh, lost Craig again. Okay, so we're gonna. let's go on. One question. Focus on this idea of indemnification was the. The limit, to the extent that indemnification comes when someone is acting in the scope of their employment, is there ever a limit to the access to indemnification based on a determination that the conduct was not appropriate, therefore not in the course of employment? I'm asking you, Will.
Okay, great. So
we've lost Craig altogether for now. I hope he's coming back.
I see his face.
You showed up somewhere else. Ah, there you are.
The short answer is, in principle, there could be. Those limits are fairly broad because the fact that you were doing something sort of outrageously illegal that you weren't supposed to do doesn't mean you weren't acting in the scope of your employment. So those come up more often. There are cases where, you know, a police officer on the weekend is at the park with his own kid and then gets into a fight with somebody and then tries to arrest them and pull a gun. Even then, a lot of the time, courts liberally construe what it is to be in the scope of their employment. But it's not just a matter of saying, you know, well, you weren't complying with the use of force policies. And then just as an empirical matter, I think Craig mentioned this, there's a Joanna Schwartz at UCLA tried to just sort of run this to ground. It is a huge set of lawsuits. What actually happened? And the answer, because in theory, there are all these limits and how uncertain is it? And the answer was, I think it was 99.8% of the judgments against police officers were ultimately indemnified. Even if the city didn't have to, in the end, they would end up doing it. I think there was like one $200 award that she was not able to track down. It might not have been indemnified in her sort of large sample of cases. So it's not 100%, but it's a number very close to 100%.
Thanks. So I have a question that I think is asking both of you to give us an answer as broad as possible, which I'll try to do a little framing for, which is, I think we often have questions, very understandable. People who are concerned, want to make a difference, want to know how each of you who focus in some very particular strategy or very particular area of the law, if you step back, because you're also wise, well-read people who care about the issues, and identified one change, one reform, one action, or set, but, you know, that would make the most difference in addressing the problems that there's broad agreement are out there, what would each of you point to and why? So it's an invitation to go outside your topic or to make a case within your topic, either way. Craig, you want to go first?
Sure, I'm going to sound like, and I said this a little bit in my opening remarks, and I'm going to sound like just a little snot-nosed kid when I say this. The thing that can make the most difference is just quit it. I mean, seriously, we can simply reduce all of these unnecessary negative encounters between police and particularly communities of color, individuals and communities of color. Unnecessary negative encounters, stop just arresting, killing, brutalizing, stopping so many Black and brown people. I think that is the single most important thing that we can do. We are looking to police to solve so many of our problems that they aren't a good fit to solve. It's like the primary tools that a police officer has, and that's unique and different from the rest of us, are the powers of arrest and the power to use force. And if you think about those tools, and if you're a hammer, everything looks like a nail, are those really good tools to address issues like mental illness, interpersonal conflict, people in crises, drug addiction, public health issues? So we can just quit and reduce so many of these negative and unnecessary negative encounters that don't have to occur, we can save a lot of lives and hopefully also then work to build better relationships.
Okay, so one step back, lawyers of the future sort of listening, what as, you know, change agents who have something to do with law in one kind of a way or another is the most promising strategy? Because you describe an end, I think, that a lot of people would agree is a good end. We're not there, and there seems to be some stubborn resistance to getting there. Just quitting makes it sound so easy. So as lawyers, what do you think is the sort of most promising sort of change that you would identify that lawyers can push at to make this happen?
So I don't think there's one magic bullet. And I think actually the problem is that people tend to look for what's the magic elixir. So whatever's sexy at the moment, body cams, community policing, more training, bah, 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 bah. There's not a magic elixir. And so what I would say in terms of guiding, and here is the thing that I think is absolutely the most important thing that lawyers could do who care about bringing about change and ending these patterns and practices of abuse, it would be support, listening to and supporting the work and working to build power and taking on the kinds of cases and challenges that are being asked of by the people who are most impacted. Some of the most important things that we've done have been, and impactful things that I think we've done on the litigation side, and that's also recognizing the limits of litigation. So litigation just being one tool, but the areas in which I think our litigation has been most effective has been at actually uncovering and exposing information, data, tools, things to really take on state secrecy, because what that fundamentally is a redistribution of power. It's taking information that's been exclusively held by the state, by the police, and power and information then by being hidden that's allowed abuse to go on with impunity, and by unearthing that, exposing, and then giving, not holding it for ourselves and under court protective orders, but being sure that then that information is accessible and usable by people most impacted. That's when I'm seeing dramatic differences. That case that we won that established the legal precedent that police misconduct records belong to the public, I'm seeing right now, because now we created a database that every day there are people who are in prison who are actually using that to get free. There are people who've been victims of civil rights violations who are using that to actually enforce their rights. That people on the ground are using that very information to engage in conversations like this about what really needs to be done to address the reality of police impunity, to address the code of silence. How does that work? What's wrong with these underlying police misconduct investigations? Why have they been so ineffectual? I think litigation has been is an incredibly powerful tool to actually bring that to light, so then we can all see it, we can evaluate it, we can criticize it, and then people on the ground, whether it be legislatively, in courts, or in the streets, can work to change it.
Will?
So I guess similarly, I think when I first think of this, I think there's a big problem, a cultural problem, which is this sense by government officials that they are different from us, that they are above the law, they are special. And it's not just a police culture problem, it's throughout different parts of the government. It's the problem that judges see themselves as more like police officers than they do as like victims of police, that prosecutors are more likely to become judges than public defenders, sort of up and down a kind of cultural sense that there's a kind of government class that plays by different rules than the rest of us. I think that problem sort of runs throughout all these legal doctrines and creates both formal and practical barriers to reform. And you think about what's the, you know, one silver bullet for attacking that, but obviously I'm drawn to qualified immunity as happening to be one of the most prominent emblems of that special status. I'm not sure as a matter of practical importance it's the most important, but it is just one of the ones that's right there. But there are a whole range of other kind of legal privileges like that, you know, ranging from the special rules police officers get when they're investigated for a crime, give them kind of an ability to get their story straight that no other defendant has, to the just the rules we have for the practices we have for picking who becomes a judge. And we tend to pick people with a long career of government service, with the result that judges think of themselves as part of the government rather than thinking of themselves as part of society. So I think there's sort of a range of both the personal and the legal doctrines that each are kind of ways of chipping away at that. But the most important thing is to chip away at this sense that there's a kind of official privileged class that gets to have different rules than the rest of us, and that sort of rules us without having to play by the rules.
Thank you. We're out of time. So thanks very much to Craig and to Will and to all of those of you who joined our discussion. Silver lining of this pandemic is that it has helped us to see how readily we can bring together alumni and students living and working throughout the world to discuss issues of importance to all of us. We look forward to seeing you again soon. Take care.